That's Albert Ayler. That's not recent. That's from the early 1960s, when it's a classic album called Spiritual Unity. The rumour has it that they missed the beginning of the track because the recording engineer thought they were still warming up.
Yeah, it's off-key. Is one of their instruments broken?
No, that is the style. It is free jazz, so it's jazz or avant-garde. Okay. So they're looking to break out of the molds and move away from the conventions. And so it is a very, very free style. It becomes more accessible the more you get to know it. But equally, it's not a good starting point. But it is what a lot of people, I think, sometimes turns people off jazz, because they say, where's the tune? Where's the melody? Where's the rhythm? They've got no identifiable markers to go at. So it's...
Doesn't that mean, though, that essentially you could just get a group of musicians together who are dreadful and they could say, well, it's just jazz?
Well, I think there's always that argument, you're dead right, about totally free jazz, and that in theory you could just get Beth, you and myself, give us an instrument and there we play something and that's free jazz. Yeah, and you could say that.
Like something modern art.
But it's, yeah, well, you've taken the words out of my mouth. It's the same sort of thing, isn't it? You go to the Tate Modern and you see some piece and think, I could do that. If it's just a blue canvas, I could get a canvas and paint it blue. I could draw a line from one corner to the other and say that's modern art. I could line up some bricks in a certain shape. It's all conceptual, isn't it? It's not so much the actual execution. You're thinking about the artist's actual conception of or ideas, and that's where it's coming from. Same with free jazz to a degree, in that, yes, its critics will say, well, anyone could do that, which could be true. If it's done well, and so I'm thinking of someone like Evan Parker, a British player who's been around for years, he can play. And so, you know, most of the really good free players have come from a traditional background. They've been schooled, they can read music, they can play, they've studied composition. They have chosen to reject those rules after years of playing and move outside into a music without boundaries.
OK, so we've got another track here then. What sort of style is this in?
So this one coming up now, you can play a little bit of it now. This is called Rambling. This goes back to the 1959, I think it was, 1960, I think it came out, or thereabouts, by Ornette Coleman, who was an avant-garde player. He was a real shock at the time. People hated his music, and it took a long time for him to be accepted. Often the case, I think, in art, and particularly in jazz, that you're always appreciated after you've died. Quite often the case, Thelonious Monk, another one in question. This was very shocking music at the time. It was, again, moving on from the bebop arena, and people found it very different. He found a style called harmelodic, so instead of improvising on the chord changes, he was giving much more of a blank canvas to his players and saying, right, have a listen, really not giving them any pointers, and just say, right, take some themes from the melody and improvise on that, rather than improvising within the actual chord structure. So it's a much freer way. Was shocking at the time. I think it sounds quite accessible now to a large degree. I've chosen this just for, in a way, just as a matter of interest, because, and we'll play in a moment, the bass player on this was a chap called Charlie Hayden. Died a few years ago, a great character, and went on to have a marvellous career in his own right. And he has a bass solo, which we're going to play just in a moment. And on that is Sex and Drugs and Rock and Roll, which people will know from Ian Dury and the Blockheads. And that's where Sex and Drugs and Rock and Roll came from, because Ian Dury quite liked a bit of jazz on the QT, and he was playing this album, and he heard this riff by Charlie Hayden and thought, hey, I quite like that, man. So he nicked it for the theme of Sex and Drugs and Rock and Roll. And he did fess up to it and said it was. He actually spoke to Charlie Hayden and said, hey, man, I nicked your theme for that. And Charlie Hayden, I don't know whether he's upset or not, but he sort of said, well, actually, music being what it is, I nicked it from a Creole song, because he used to be playing with his family band as a young boy. And it's actually an old Creole song from years before, a folk song. And he used to integrate musics from his childhood into his solos. So that's where Sex and Drugs and Rock and Roll actually comes from, Creole French songs from the 1950s.
Well, there we go. I think we have learned something. Let's have a little listen to that. Howard, thank you very much. We look forward to seeing you next week. But you've also got Sweet and Swing. Give that a little bit of a plug.
We have got Sweet and Swing. I'm just recording it as we speak in the studio next door. We've got, we're doing our big band ballads. We've been listening to Cab Calloway. And we've also been doing theme songs of the big bands. And I've got a winner this week, and I'm going to give him a bit of a nomination as well. Brian, he's not even on the island.
Wonderful. Howard, the jazz man. See you next week.